and effectively contribute to the shaping of constructed environments through a practice that integrates material production and design discourse. Its studio's work has appeared in Interior Design, Dwell, Art Forum, Texas ArchConnect, Tripeza, and Snap, among many other print and digital publications. Siddiqui regularly writes articles, book chapters, and essays that engage the subject matter of his design work with its broader critical contexts. Before arriving in Texas, he taught at several other American institutions, including the University of Pennsylvania, the California College of Arts, and Parsons, the New School of Design. Preceding his work with this studio are several years of professional practice with 1100 ArchConnect and Cohn Peterson Fox Associates. Igor is joining us in the studio for 3 days to run a workshop entitled Object Cohorts, looking at new methods for designing families of objects rather than individual objects. I had the opportunity to study under Igor while at the University of Texas, and I still consider him a mentor. We are honored to have him here at Cranbrook for the first time. I want to thank everyone for coming, and join me in welcoming Igor Siddiqui.
It's so nice to be here. Thank you, Ravina, for the introduction, and to the 3D department for having me. It's been an awesome couple of days, and I'm excited to see what you end up with tomorrow. So I'm looking forward to our next meeting tomorrow. I had a really end up, also thanks to Scott, of course, for making all of this happen. I had a really wonderful time doing studio visits with all the students in the 3D department, and the always inspiring thing about studio visits and with graduate students who are trying to figure out their thesis is this question of what is my voice, or what am I trying to figure out, and what am I going to do when I get out of here? And I find these questions to be always so fresh, because you actually don't stop thinking about these things even when other people think that you're already doing things in the world. You kind of wonder if you are, or how you are doing it. So today what I will show you is, I'll share with you some of my work really looking at how a studio got started and what kinds of projects keep it going. I recently had the opportunity to reflect upon my own body of work, and these issues of autonomy and ambiguity really kept coming up in a kind of mode of reflection. And I think of these terms in a really personal and intuitive way. I think autonomy is so much about figuring out how to do what you want to do. And then the other piece of it is how what you're doing is perceived, whether that's it's perceived by others or even in your own self-reflection. And that's where sometimes ambiguity comes in, trying to figure out what the thing that you're doing actually is, how you would refer to it. And of course, these issues also have disciplinary ramifications. We often talk about the autonomy of disciplines, but then also at the same time, we spend so much time talking about crossover practice and interdisciplinarity. So I would say that actually, at least in my own work, some ambiguity has actually been quite productive. And so some of these conversations about architecture and interior design and product design coming together. For some students, it's about sculpture and design coming together. These are actually different modes of ambiguity that can be very productive. Earlier today, we were talking about Donald Judd's essay, Specific Objects, which is about a certain point in time in American art when there was this kind of emerging art that was neither painting nor sculpture, and yet there was so much about it that was important when it was emerging. So I was lucky to start my practice in New York City with a number of commissions for real clients. And they were small projects with a lot of detail and very little square footage. So this is a pool house on top of an existing brownstone in facing Turtle Bay in Manhattan. This is a private suite for a painter and a dancer. And this is a gallery for the Park Foundation. And in this shot, you see an installation by the Center for Land Use Interpretation. It was a part of their program. Different houses. This is a house for LA-based artist Mallory Martyr. And then other interiors for private clients. And then also a part of the kind of the earlier wave of kind of storefront architecture in Brooklyn. And then I started teaching full time and the economy tanked. And after all of this kind of client-based work, I kind of went back to studio to figure out what else I wanted to do. And like the students, a lot of the work was actually self-initiated. And it's interesting that in trying to kind of develop a position in design practice, it was these projects that have really sustained my practice, not these kind of isolated client-based projects. So when I started teaching full-time and I started having access to the kind of studio facilities that when you're, you know, renting a small office in Brooklyn, you don't have the same kind of access to things, I was finally able to output from my computer things in sort of material terms. And at that time, I really was able to get my hands on digital fabrication machinery that I wouldn't have otherwise had access to. A lot of work at the time was really obsessed with patterns. So over the past couple of days, we talked a lot about kind of code and scripting. And I was really interested in how two-dimensional patterns became something three-dimensional. I mean, of course, as an architect, even things that are flat, you kind of wish that they were, that they had a certain kind of depth. And so you wonder about what that depth is in material terms, what it might be as a structure, or what it might be as a space. So it was about taking kind of scripted patterns and figuring out what their application might be. And that, you know, for a while was kind of defined in pretty loose terms. And so I would say that the work that I was doing at the time was, on the one hand, about finding ways to output kind of digital content, but also finding applications that had to do with both surface articulations of surface and also structure. So the interesting thing about this way of working was to work with patterns and then models that could be evaluated at full scale. So these are kind of full-scale prototypes of architectural screens, but also as these kind of form-finding machines that yielded work at other scales. So this is a competition entry for a beach resort where the pattern from the previous project was taken and then developed as a kind of as a structure that was inhabitable in different ways. So this was a competition entry, and then the proposal was picked up by a developer, and then it was put on hold. And architecture takes a long time, and sometimes it's like a cat with nine lives, where you're just waiting for the next life to kick in again. And then at the same time, I started working with different manufacturers, again, trying to just make something that wasn't in my computer, that had kind of a material or physical dimension to it. So I was working with these other tessellated patterns, and this was kind of a speculative kind of autonomous island, sort of after Super Studio, this kind of environment that could be constructed using a kind of a stack of tiles. But then actually got really lucky and worked with a flooring company to actually help them deal with a problem that they had. And I was talking to the students here about this yesterday. Sort of on the one hand, having this kind of abstract, sort of computationally driven work in the computer, and then finding ways to connected to something else. So in this case, this is the client was the Aronson's Flooring Company from New York. They had this surplus of floor tiles at the time. Floor tiles were not recyclable because they had a rubber backing. And so we're just trying to find a way to detour the product from landfill and to try to maybe find a way to kind of project a new value onto an otherwise useless material remnant. So we developed this tessellation that then yielded an area rug. And then this was really interesting because this is the first kind of realized, albeit at a small scale, kind of mass customized product with the idea that every time you produce a rug, it's a slightly different pattern, of course, because the pattern is animated, because it's a dynamic pattern. And then also, of course, because you're dealing with material remnants, that as well also varies. And that's the rug installed in its final home after it was exhibited for about 4 years. So it was this kind of traveling rug that then finally settled here in this house by Bercy Chen Architects in Austin, which is a really fantastic piece of architecture that I wish I had done, but I didn't. And then other ways, entering competitions and trying to find ways to make things. I did this project for the Decor Art and Architecture Festival in New Orleans in collaboration with Matt Hutchinson, my colleague from college, California College of the Arts, and a frequent collaborator. I developed this project, Bioluminescence, as a public installation. One of the constraints of this public program was that it's only viewed at night, which is very New Orleans. It makes a lot of sense. But also it was a way to use installations to give the public access to spaces that are otherwise private or inaccessible to the general public. This is a really fantastic way to think about how temporary architecture can kind of reshape public life in a city. So our piece was sited at the end of a private alley in the Marigny neighborhood of New Orleans, just east of the French Quarter. And here, the fascination and the obsession really with patterns took on a new form. In the earlier projects, you see that the tessellation is really about this kind of painstaking assembly of components, which I know that some of you know what that's like. And so in this project, I was really trying to figure out how to scale up in terms of fabrication, because most of these projects, I mean, some of the fabrication is outsourced, but it really is most of these projects are sort of realized in the kind of spirit of design build projects. So Matt and I collaborated long distance. He's in San Francisco, I'm in Austin. The whole project was designed parametrically. Matt produced the steel structure for the installation, and I cast the parametric skin. And this was really a test for us to see the kind of how this kind of long distance perfect fit would work. And we sent a couple of pieces via FedEx back and forth to do the fittings, but the whole piece, I think we gave it like 4 days to put it up because we were afraid that our tolerances would be a little bit more of a pain than they were. But we actually managed to install the whole thing in about 3 or 4 hours. So there's a lot of beer drinking afterwards, which was good. So you kind of see how the skin is fabricated. It's shallow relief formwork. The panel size is restricted or constrained by the 4x8 sheets of MDF that I used to fabricate the formwork. And then the thickness was really about finding different line weights, if you will. I mean, if, in a way, this is still kind of a process of figuring out how to make drawings real. And so even the formwork, in a way, is a drawing, if you think about it, and then finding ways through a kind of a tensile structure to make that drawing three-dimensional. So you kind of see the kind of strategy of thinking volumetrically and then also kind of unfolding for fabrication. And then you kind of see the kind of qualities as it is installed in New Orleans. And so I think for both of us, even though our research interests are actually quite different, this project really pushed both of our practices in some really interesting directions. For him, with kind of custom steel fabrication, and for me, with further materials research. So one of the issues with this project, and for anyone who has cast silicone or rubber, you know that you're basically creating for yourself the most toxic environment. And the story that I always tell is that when I was fabricated bioluminescence, I was living in a live-work space, and the space got pretty toxic. I got sort of paranoid, so I lived in a hotel for a while. And I just didn't want to live that way anymore. And I didn't think it was just a matter of getting a different kind of workspace. But I was really interested in what other materials we could be working with. This also tied in with issues of customization. Most of the projects that I had done up to this point, the customization really came through the form, but the material is actually off the shelf. I mean, you're kind of casting a material, so you could say that you're kind of adjusting the kind of the qualities of a liquid material through the kind of modulation of thickness and a kind of line weight, but really wanted to go beyond that. So in this next project called Protoplastic that I produced for Topps Gallery in Memphis, really started looking at bioplastics. And so in this project, the goal was to kind of reach the same kind of scale of the previous work, but actually to produce all the bioplastic from scratch. So my space was no longer toxic, but there was a lot of hot bioplastic that was cooked, and you can see it cast here. And it was really a way to begin to think about how material qualities could be designed from scratch. So not really thinking about material and form separately, where you're just trying to find the right material to realize a form, but actually use the kind of the design of the material as a part of the design equation itself. Of course, there's something quite perverse about using petroleum-based acrylic to cast bioplastic. And that was actually a part of the project. Of course, in some ways, I mean, this research has become more viable at the time. Of course, the thing about producing an art gallery project is really about perception and awareness and really kind of a conversation with the public. And so really for this project, the goal was to generate a discussion about things that, I mean, this is really obvious, of course, but things that are kind of, I don't know, a little bit funky and yet totally clean, and then things that are kind of white and shiny, but they're actually totally toxic. So, and this is actually I've done a number of these bioplastic projects now. We learned how to deal with mold in this early project. It even got a little moldy, and so it just kind of sat there. It just got more gross. So everyone thought that the white pieces were really beautiful, but those were really the toxic ones. And of course, the interesting thing about it is that the formwork ends up being the thing that's in an addition that's collectible. And then we actually had a ceremony a composting ceremony for the project at a queer-owned organic farm in Arkansas. So that was a nice, and it's a snapshot from the project's end. And then these projects actually became a way to think about materials research and education in a way. I've produced a number of pieces through public workshops. This piece is called Sugar Free. I actually made the participants eat the plastic. I flavored it with a raspberry flavoring. It wasn't very good, but it was edible, and it was sugar-free. So just really thinking about or finding new ways to think about materiality. I mean, you actually would think that architects think a lot about materials, but we think a lot about drawing, and then we know about chipboard, which becomes concrete, and basswood, which becomes wood. So this is a way to kind of go beyond my own disciplinary hang-ups and limitations. And then this research yielded a project that I did for Think East, which was an Art Place America creative placemaking project. We were a small part of the kind of the much, much larger program that was produced for a Superfund site. It's essentially a part of Austin, Texas, that heavily polluted site, and we're basically looking at different ways to have public discussions about the future of the site. So we're invited to talk about materiality. Project, which is actually the only project that I've done kind of with students through teaching, was Edible Materials Lab. So we looked at materials through the lens of food, and we did it in two different ways. On the left are materials that are produced from scratch using food-based materials. So, so things that you're already familiar with, you know, the mushroom bricks, the algae-based plastics, 3D printed salt. We used symbiotic colonies of bacteria and yeast to produce cellulose, and things that we already knew were kind of in the air, but we wanted to really consolidate that research and also figure out how to do all that stuff ourselves. And so you kind of see kind of on the left a kind of a DIY library of material samples that we made from raw materials. So some really interesting discoveries, like how to cast concrete really thin, like paper thin. You can do it if you add gum to it, gum which is used as a preservative in different foods, but if you add it to concrete, you can have these, it's like tortillas. And then invited other colleagues to be a part of it. So this is Emerging Objects from San Francisco, Virginia Sanfratello and Ron Rael. We invited them to, so they're doing a lot of 3D printing in the Bay Area. We invited them to do something for us that had to do with food. So they got really obsessed with this idea. And so they made coffee cups from coffee, teapots from tea, sugar spoons from sugar, salt shakers from salt. And I think that they've actually kept this going, and now they have made wine glasses from Chardonnay grape skins. But it was also a way to look at our conventional materials collection. So these are all, actually, if I go back, you can see it, like the samples on the right. Those are all materials that are actually available on the market currently, but they all have a connection with food in some way. So it was one way was to kind of like generate stuff, and then the other one was kind of to have a specific kind of lens to sort through materials that already existed. And we knew that all this stuff was already in the air, and that, you know, food is talked about in so many different ways. We didn't think that it was, even though, of course, there are materials that have some connection to food. And really what we discovered through the lens of food, it was a way to talk about waste. And so it was this kind of oblique entry into issues of sustainability, which was really exciting. So a slightly perverse way of talking about something important. And then somehow, through all this materials research, I got in touch, I got an email from these really wonderful curators from Estonia. And they said, well, you're the materials person and we're curating the next Tallinn Architecture Biennale. Would you do a project for us? And so I was one of 10 architects featured in the Biennale, and we were asked to make something from scratch. So I had to make some plastic. But really the project was, they were looking for sort of full-scale prototypes of things, but also things that could be models. And so in this project called Sai, it was really about the kind of the ambiguity of something that's at full scale again, and also something that is a model of something else at another scale. And in that sense, it almost becomes, as in some of the earlier projects, a kind of a form-finding device. So there are three different parts to the project. There is a kind of a base that's made from recyclable and recycled foam. There's a kind of a middle set of sleeves cast from bioplastic that's biodegradable, and then a series of 3D printed objects. The whole project was designed so that it would fit in four boxes that I could bring with me as checked-in luggage, because it fabrication time was really too short, and I just had to work on this project until the very end, so I couldn't ship it to Tallinn 2 months before the exhibition opened. So we just decided to use the full, 100% of the volume contained by four of the largest boxes. Like so it was 20 by 20 by 20. Because most airlines add the three dimensions, so as long as you're under 62, I think, or 64, you're fine. So there were four 20 by 20 by 20 volumes, and then we decided that we would just take that volume as mass and then kind of divide it into packaging, which yielded a script that bisected these volumes into these kind of matchmaking or book matching, tiles that would make the topography, which would be the base of the whole project. So you see this kind of series, a cohort of tiles that literally pack three-dimensionally. And then all the other objects, so you kind of see this kind of topography that's cut from the objects. That's really to make room for these bioplastic sleeves when they're flattened. So really the whole bioplastic thing was made as if you, just like clothing, except it was cast. And so Sai, if you don't know, is this seam right here. Well, on my sweatshirt, it's like down here. But so it was a way to think about how to think about sleeves architecturally. And then the 3D printed objects are actually packed underneath, like on the bottom. So eight of these tiles have hidden 3D printed objects in them. And when it comes together, it's this strange thing. So it was really about kind of materials research and how it connects to formal research, and then how these things are about this kind of circulation of materials. And then you see, I don't know if you can see this drawing very well, but you can kind of see the whole assembly here. These are the sleeves. And so really kind of looking at the potential of these models, let's say, to study a catenary structure and the kind of material effects that are possible. So kind of simultaneously working at different scales. And then this kind of family of objects, where it's really the same pattern that was developed for the bioplastic pieces, but then here it's seen very differently because it's seen as a kind of extrusion. So even though they're scaled, now we're actually working with robotic arms to figure out how to drag bioplastic through in space to make these things three-dimensional so that they don't have to be cast and there's no more formwork. And then some, it's just pleasure for the eyes, just sort of images of the spaces that these models produce. And then this fascination with catenary geometries came back in a more straightforward way in this next project. We were invited by the Fusebox Festival, which is really sort of the coolest performing arts festival in Texas, to design their kind of social hub during their two-week event. And so we decided, and so they had access to this really old school German social club, which was really difficult architecturally. And in, I don't know, in terms of making it work for this event, but it had a really beautiful kind of double height dance hall. So we're really able to use the section of the building to make a ceiling piece that would really transform the whole environment. So we were interested in these really simple lighting effects, which was really the kind of knowing that red, green, and blue light makes CMY shadows. And so, of course, many artists have looked at this before. But we also knew, as you see in the video on the right, that when you project RGB light onto colored surfaces, that this process of subtraction happens. And so we were able to kind of calibrate the lights and the colored surfaces to always make a kind of monochromatic image. And this has actually been done before. Like there, I think there's a European company that does wallpaper that if you kind of illuminate the space differently, you kind of see different images. But we really wanted to do it architecturally so that this thing made space. So rather than it being a flat surface, to really just see it as a kind of as a space-making device, something that was already more three-dimensional. So just the logic of it was that it was a series of sort of catenary geometries. So this was all kind of developed parametrically, only because it was really the best way to study it, as a because it's actually a dynamic structure. It's a net. So as simple as it may look, it's kind of a nightmare to fabricate. So it's a catenary net that then has secondary and tertiary bands of colored material, and then a kind of pattern that was differentiated, but that had basically a kind of a repeated kind of pattern of bays. So each bay is different in terms of the pixels, let's say, but when illuminated with a red, green, and blue light, it more or less produced the same kind of figure. And you see the kind of the logic behind the catenary structure, so you also see that it had to be tailored to work with the kind of ceiling heights and also to provide a kind to make this kind of volume. So it's not a it's not at all a kind of a uniform extrusion. It really is a kind of it's a net. You kind of see that here, hopefully. And then you see the kind of figures that we had in mind that would have a way at a kind of larger scale to remake space. And then, so this is white light, red light, green light, and blue light, and a party. And then we did this in other places with graphics too. So we made these columns. So we made these sort of graphic columns because we had to find a way to kind of distribute this graphic material without, but still having pieces that were sort of freestanding. And of course, this made a lot of sense because most of you maybe don't know this, but Charles Moore spent the kind of last chunk of his life in Austin as the in the late 80s, and he made these insane sort of pomo columns made from cardboard tubes, and so we thought it was time to bring it back. And then you see that this happens in terms of lighting. I mean, this is a performing arts festival, so it made sense to kind of engage issues of theater, which of course, you know, has to do with light, but also kind of do it in different ways. So also some of these projects, I think you can also think of in terms of being didactic as kind of public programs, which I'm not talking about as much today, but in a way, all of these projects kind of are that. So another installation, this project was done for the Metro Show Art Fair in New York City. And it's kind of an interesting art fair. It was kind of a hodgepodge of, I don't know, like Americana collections, outsider art, like this kind of weird laundry list of things. It felt to us like it was a little bit like an art fair for all the things that don't belong in other art fairs in New York City. But also they were really kind of interested in the kind of this kind of both history of decoration, but also interested in kind of renewing what that means today. So we just decided that we would do something with wallpaper. And actually this project was done before RGB Hub. So we were just kind of interested in seeing the kind of how far we could push graphics again three-dimensionally. So we developed the project. This was done in collaboration with Deborah Schneiderman. We did this kind of zigzag wall, this kind of Missoni-like wall with this kind of alternating concave-convex pairs of panels and then graphics that were layered. So you see that if you kind of start in the middle, there's a kind of gradient of blues and greens that kind of accentuates the depth of the panels at the creases. And then moving up, there is a kind of pairing of two kinds of wallpaper. One, which is this kind of 19th or like, you know, pre-20th century idea about repetition. And then on the other, this kind of parametric pattern that doesn't repeat. And then the kind of the top overlay is this kind of faux material condition, which is this kind of net that plays again with depth in another way. And then we were looking at anamorphic projection, as you can see here, and kind of projecting these kind of patterned images, which are sampled from the collection that was produced, that as an image would flatten from certain privileged points of view. So you see those kind of isolated on top. And also a kind of a virtual shadow. So I think we have a project in the studio about virtual shadows. So here too, because it was an interior without daylight, we thought that we would actually deal with the floor as a kind of virtual shadow, which you kind of see here. So I've been there before. And then again, kind of looking at ways to mobilize graphics spatially. So, you know, working within the constraints of, you know, we can only use panels, we can only print content, finding ways to bring that into space, which, you know, I think the pictures are actually quite accurate in terms of how that worked optically. This is a recent project. We were commissioned to do a series of backdrops for South by Southwest Eco, which is a conference in Austin. So it was meant to be conceived as a kind of as a family of backdrops. There were eight different stages. The largest stage, which was for the keynote, was 40 feet in width. Then there was a slightly smaller one, and then a bunch of kind of baby ones that were 10 feet wide. And so we had to really think of this as a series as well. And so we developed a series of kind of freestanding structures that were kind of differentiated, that had a pattern filled in with essentially robotic paintings. So our inspiration was Ettore Sozza's Adesso Però bookcase. We liked the kind of serrated profile, but we didn't like that it was this kind of mass-produced repetition. So it's the repetition of the same. So we really wanted to figure out how to kind of script the edges, but still have them be compatible in some ways. And this isn't all of them, but I just zoomed in on some so that you can see them because they're very small otherwise, but you can kind of see that they kind of get smaller towards the center and wider at the top and the bottom, and then that they also have this kind of alternating pattern. I think it was like 3, 6, 8, 12. I don't remember anymore. But this is a cluster of them, and you can kind of see which ones would be compatible once they were to kind of be connected. In this kind of first iteration, what connects them are the robotic marks. So we made a really simple script. This was the first project that we produced with the set of KUKA arms that we just got last fall. And so at our school and in our environment, there are these like old school people on our faculty that still love talking about the mark of the hand, which could be really annoying. But we decided that we would just like explore the mark of the robotic hand. And so we just were really looking for kind of idiosyncratic marks that these robots could make. So you see some of the kind of rotations that are introduced that make that kind of vary the width of the line weight. But it was also just a way to, again, do something very simple and two-dimensional, but something that could actually have tectonic implications. And then the whole thing is actually designed so that so it could be reassembled in a completely different environment. So we're actually tailoring these pieces for a retail environment now. But on the opening day, Robert Kennedy Jr. was giving a keynote, and we were there, and we were like, wow, we wanted these marks to be primitive. And my collaborator was like, yep, really primitive. And so this was kind of interesting to us because it's a great conference, but also there is so much kind of conversation about innovation and disruption. But at the end of the day, it's still pretty corporate. And so we're very happy to kind of do something that was aesthetically not entirely consistent with that kind of environment. And these are some shots of our painting. And then I will end with this last project. It's been really interesting to me to work at this kind of tangible scale of making, but really do most of these projects in the public realm. And I think that this is also shaped by my role in our community as an educator, and as kind of, so on the one hand, it's being able to engage with different audiences, just having that access and kind of having that role. But also, I think it's about finding different ways to scale up the work. So, and we talked a little bit about that yesterday. So it doesn't necessarily have to mean making something bigger. It can mean engaging other audiences. It can mean working with more people. It can mean facilitating other people's work. It can mean many, many different things. So this was an interesting project called Field Constructs. And I guess about 3 years ago, I was talking to a curator friend and a magazine editor friend, and I was, and they were writing an article about some of my work, and I was talking about how lucky I was that you know, there when you know, in the first couple of years of my own practice, I was able to do work through competitions, and how kind it is in a way that these things exist and that people do them. And so I think, I don't know why we decided to do this, but we decided to launch a competition for young designers, and to kind of reverse our roles. So rather than kind of entering competitions, to actually design a competition for other people to enter. So we partnered up with a nonprofit organization called Ecology Action of Texas. Ecology Action of Texas owns Circle Acres, which is a 10-acre site in East Austin, really at the kind of at the periphery of the city. As we started thinking about what the competition could be, and also in talking to this nonprofit organization that has this piece of land, which is a formal a former landfill, with a kind of so they've been going through this process of remediation and trying to figure out how to engage the public with this relatively remote site. And so we really wanted to figure out a way to bring together this kind of innovative, the world of innovative installation design with this kind of like do good nonprofit work. It seems like these worlds don't always talk to each other. I mean, this is just an observation based on my own city. I'm sure it works differently in other places, but we thought that there was an opportunity for that kind of for that kind of partnership. So we launched an international competition. There were jury selection finalists. We had really interesting, jury. John Grade, the installation artist from Seattle, was on it. Benjamin Ball from Ball Nogas from LA was on it. And a number of other people that are kind of familiar with that way of working. We ended up with four winners, and we raised, the three of us, Catherine Gavin, Rachel Adams, and myself, raised the funding to realize four projects and to organize public programs during a two-week period in November of 2015. And this was really, so Austin has a citywide, or East Austin has a kind of a neighborhood-wide open studios program called East Austin Studio Tours. In for 2 weeks in November, we were able to kind of become their feature event, effectively expanding their the footprint of their program way outside of this kind of hipster part of Austin. And it was really interesting to see how and why people came to the site. And actually, it was a very interesting way to see how little, in terms of intervention, one needs to generate this kind of engagement between this kind of urban landscape and the public. This project was by Invivia, Brad Cantrell from the Graduate School of Design at Harvard, and his team. This project called Duck Blind in Plain Sight is by Jonathan Schultze, Jennifer Berkland, and JP Rashavi, a team of young architects and landscape architects from New York. This project is by Corey Beig, and then this is a project by Roland Snooks, based in Melbourne in Australia. And this is a really interesting way to kind of bring this back through curating, but also exhibition design, to make a connection between this urban site and then a gallery exhibition that documented all this work that happened in the city. So these are some of the things, some of the wayfinding at the site, kind of rerouting the traffic and making a new entrance into the site. And then kind of finding a way to kind of bring a representation of this enclave into the gallery. So we used the figure of the site, scaled it to the size of the gallery, and then made this kind of parametric landscape that is a kind of surface that yielded these discs that had all the jury selections, finalists, and winners. And then this is the installation itself. So again, even though it kind of makes in as a kind of aggregate, kind of a single island, as a kind of autonomous enclave, it was another kind of exercise in mass customization, because each kind of oval disc is actually unique, both in height and in its own geometry. And then each of the kind of little welded connections also had its own height. So this is where the spreadsheets from Grasshopper are really helpful. So, and then this is the resulting installation. So I think that's enough for this evening. Thank you.